Brothers and sisters in Christ, every year at Easter during the time of the Christian Passover, we celebrate our redemption through the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Lent is a time to prepare for this celebration and to practice with discipline daily repentance, our daily dying and rising in union with Christ. Ash Wednesday is not about penance or even about fasting. It's about repentance. We mourn over our sin, but we do not despair. We so often treat sin as a concept, as a psychological barrier, as something distant from us. But that is not what it is. It is our rebellion against the God of life. It is our systematic dismissal of God's loving kindness. Sin is personal. But we live our lives blind to the fact that we are sinful. For us, it is always someone else, something else, or even God himself that is responsible for sin and evil in our world. But we know that that is not true, that sin comes from within us, from our own hearts. And so we gather on Ash Wednesday to remember and to mourn that it is us who has broken the world. We begin this season by acknowledging our need for repentance and for the mercy and forgiveness proclaimed in the gospel of Jesus Christ. So if you would, please repeat the appropriate passages. O Lord, open my lips.
My mouth will declare your praise.
You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it.
You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings.
The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit.
A broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise.
We will sing, "Holy, holy, holy," that my heart and God will do just as I am.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, earth.
coming to life of the new self is wholehearted joy in God through Christ, and a delight to every kind of good as God wants us to do. Together, as Christ's body, we now confess our sin and express our longing to live in joyful obedience to God. Please see the words on the screen and follow after me. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions.
Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin.
Surely you desire truth in the inner parts. You teach me wisdom in the inmost place. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me.
Rock of ages, left for me. Very high, myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from the roof inside which flow be a singer.
Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. He was wounded for our transgression, bruised for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole, and with his stripes we are healed. He will feed his flock like a shepherd and gather the lambs in his arms. Please read this prayer on the screen with me. May God the Father, who does not despise the broken spirit, give us contrite hearts. May Christ, who bore our sins in his body on the tree, heal us by his wounds. May the Holy Spirit, who leads us into all truth, speak words of pardon and peace. Amen.
I want to thank everybody for coming tonight, whether you're here in person or whether you're here joining us from home. We're glad that you can join us on this Ash Wednesday. If you would, take out your Bibles, whether that's on a phone or maybe the pew Bible in front of you. And we're going to turn this evening to John chapter 11, tonight we'd like to do just a reflection on Jesus and the death of Lazarus. So again, we're turning to John, 4th Gospel, chapter 11. So if you would follow along, we're going to read the first four verses. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus, of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent to him, saying, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Let us pray together. Father, I just come before you tonight, and I thank you for this time together. During the middle of the week, as we enter into the season of Lent, Father, I pray that you would give us hearts that are malleable, that are able to be formed into the hearts that you need us to be. Father, that you, through your Spirit, help us to be convicted of our sin and that it would lead to repentance. So, Father, I pray that you would be with us this evening. May this time glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen. So what I love about this passage is that we see how personal Jesus is. Here, Jesus is so involved in the lives of Mary and Martha. We see Mary and Martha, these two sisters who love Jesus so much. One can't stop working and serving and trying to do more and more for Jesus. And the other sister, she sits at Jesus' feet at the consternation of the other sister. "Why aren't you doing anything?" And these two sisters, their brother is ill. And here, as he's dying, they reach out to the one that they know that can make a difference, that can help save him from his deathbed. And so they send word to Jesus. And Jesus was on mission, and he wasn't able to leave right away. And so he said, "This is not a sickness that's going to lead to death, but this is for the glory of God, and that the Son of God may be glorified through this." Here, Jesus loves this family. And we see that he wants to be here. And the purpose of this story, the purpose that we hear this, is because Jesus is going to be glorified through it. And I hope that's what we see in it tonight. We're going to continue the story in verse 11. And it says, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will recover." Now Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought that he meant taking rest and sleep. And then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus has died. And for your sake, I am glad that I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." So Thomas called the twin and said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." So this gives us a little bit more context of how close Jesus and his disciples were to Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. Here, Mary was the one that we will see that will take the jar of alabaster full of perfume and anoint Jesus before his death. This jar is more than a year's pay, and she's going to break it and anoint Jesus with it. This is the type of love that we see throughout Jesus and this family and the disciples. Here we even see Thomas, doubting Thomas, calling the twin and telling the fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with them." They were sad at the death of their friend Lazarus. But I think one of the important things that we need to understand as we see this passage, as we get ready to enter into Lent, is that this is a beautiful picture of the gospel. The good news is that Jesus descended to us, that we don't have to ascend to Jesus. We do not have to climb a ladder of religious duty, of religious activities. But Jesus goes where he needs to be, and so he left heaven. He left the comfort of heaven to come and descend and to enter into our pain and brokenness. And here we see the same thing happening in real time with the family of Lazarus.
with the friends of Lazarus, even with the disciples. Jesus is going to the family. He is descending into the pain, the suffering, and entering in. So this is a beautiful picture of how we need to engage our family, our friends, our neighbors in the gospel. Oftentimes, one of the mantras of this world is that we need to pull ourselves up by our own bootstraps. But if that was the case here, Lazarus would have to raise himself from the dead. But thankfully, the good news is that it's not up to us. It's about Jesus engaging us, coming in and exploding onto the scene to help restore what is broken. And that's what we're experiencing during Lent. That's what we're celebrating at Easter, that Jesus came and died for us. In verse 17 through 23, it says, "Now when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles, and many of the Jews had come to Mary and Martha to console them concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him. But Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, 'Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you.' And Jesus said to her, 'Your brother will rise again.' Martha said to him, 'I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day.' And Jesus said to her, 'I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?' And she said to him, 'Yes, Lord, I believe you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world. So here Martha hears that Jesus is coming, that he is on his way. And she is eager to come to him. Now, again, Martha is the one that she's the one that does everything, right? She's the one that is cleaning, that is preparing the food. And of course, she is the first one to meet with Jesus. Now, as she has just lost her loved one, you can tell there's pain in her voice in the sense that she asked Jesus, "First, if you would have been here, you would still be with us. Where were you, Jesus?" That's the first question. But oftentimes, Martha's religiosity has a hard time of putting on that honesty, that authentic nature. And so she covers it up by coming right back at Jesus. "I know that you're going to make things all okay." So we see the brokenness, but still that she's trying to put on this sense that "I still believe in you and I'm still religious, so don't hold it against me." But Jesus, he enters into her pain. He sees her pain and he reassures her that he is the resurrection and the life. That here, yes, she believes that one day Jesus will resurrect the dead, but she doesn't believe it's going to be this day. But Jesus reassures her that no, that he is the resurrection of God and the life. That he will bring new life, even today. And then he asks her a personal question. "Do you believe this? Do you believe me?" Which is a question that Jesus is asking us tonight, that he's asking us throughout Lent. Do you believe I am who I say I am? Do you believe I am the Christ? Do you believe I am the Messiah? Do you believe that I am making all things new? Many of us who have been believers for any amount of time, our faith grows dull. We have friends, relatives, the tragedies happen that die suddenly, like Lazarus. We have a difficult time with friends or family. We have sickness. We have chronic illness. We have earthquakes, war, mass shootings. "Jesus, where are you?" But Jesus is asking, "Do you believe I am the resurrection and the life?" What is our answer? What is your answer? Verse 28. When she had said this, she went in and called her sister Mary, saying in private, "The teacher is here, and he is calling for you." And when she heard it, she rose quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still in the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who were there with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary rise quickly and go out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep there. Now when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would have not died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. And he said, "Where have you laid him?" And they said to him, "Lord, come and see." Verse 35, Jesus wept. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could he not, who opened the eyes of the blind man, also have kept this man from dying?" Mary, the one who loved Jesus so much, she took this amazing gift and broke it at Jesus' feet to anoint him. She didn't even come out. She wasn't even one of the first people to come out to meet with him. Her sister had to come and say, "Mary, the teacher is asking for you." And as soon as she knew that Jesus wanted to see her, she sprang up, she rose quickly and came to him. Now Mary is a little bit more emotional. She's more engaged with her emotions. She just is her true self. And so she asks the question, even her sister asks, "Lord, if you had been there, my brother would not have died." What a difficult question. How many times have we said this? Jesus, where are you? Why did you allow this to happen? Why are you continuing to allow this to happen? I pray and I pray and I pray, and yet you're not here. But Mary doesn't even pull back. She just leans in. She falls at his feet, and weeping, she lets out all of her angst, all of her sadness at the feet of Jesus. And it stirs even her friends and her companions around her, the other Jews that have come with her. And Jesus begins crying. What a beautiful picture of who Jesus is, how he's engaged with his emotions. Oftentimes in our society, it's not okay to cry. But here we see the Lord of the universe, the creator of all things, engaging with his emotions. And why? Is this because that Lazarus is dead and he's not coming back? No, Jesus knows what's going to happen. He knows the rest of the story. He knows why he's come. This is to glorify God. He knows that here in a few hours, Lazarus is going to come out of the grave. So he's not crying for his friend. So why is Jesus crying? He's crying because he knows that our sin and rebellion causes death. It causes brokenness. And here Jesus is seeing the effects of sin, brokenness, and rebellion firsthand in the lives of those lives that Lazarus touched, the impact, the ripples that we see Lazarus affecting the sisters, the disciples, the Jewish people. We see all the sadness that it's bringing over this beloved person of their community. And so Jesus begins weeping. So we know from this passage that any time that we experience brokenness, any time we experience tragedy, any time that we are feeling overwhelmed, that Jesus is with us, and that he is mourning with us, that he is grieving with us because of the brokenness, because of the sin that we experience. And this is why Jesus is coming, to make all things new. Verse 38. Then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. And Jesus said, "Take away the stone." And Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, by this time there will be an odor, for he has been dead 4 days." And Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you'd always hear me, but I said on this account of the people standing around, that they may believe that you sent me." When he said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The man
So here they bring Jesus to the tomb. No one believes this is going to happen. Even the Jewish people said, if Jesus would have been here, he would still be alive. They don't think this is an option. The variable is not even in the equation that Lazarus may come forth out of this tomb. And here Jesus, in the scene we'll see at Easter, about being buried in a cave and a stone being placed in front of the tomb, we see Martha being the one that's always thinking, that's always planning. Jesus says, roll away the stone. And of course, Martha speaks up saying, Jesus, it's going to smell really bad. Have you thought this through? And Jesus reminds them, I told you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God. So he commands Lazarus to come forth. And Lazarus comes out with his feet bound with linen strips and his face wrapped with cloth. And he says, unbind him and let him go. And this is a picture of us. That Jesus is coming to us because he loves us. We are dead in our trespasses and sins, in our rebellion. We don't have a choice. That dead people are unable to choose. And Jesus pursues us. And he calls to us by name. And he says, come forth. And he says, unbind him and let him go. Our chains of sin, our chains of rebellion are released. Our chains of death are released. And we are free once again. So the story about Jesus and Lazarus isn't just about Lazarus. It's also about us, our friends, our relatives that need the gospel. During our time of Lent, during Ash Wednesday, we are reminded that death is a reality. As I preached on Sunday, we should be preparing in this service for our own death. Some of us may feel like that's closer than others. But we do not know what tomorrow holds. And so we come tonight reflecting not just on the death of a loved one of Jesus 2,000 years ago, but we reflect our own death, our physical death that will one day come, our spiritual death whenever we sin against God, but also the brokenness and destruction that our sin causes those around us. So my encouragement for us tonight, or my encouragement for us at Lent, is to remind ourselves of the story of Lazarus, that we are all dead. We all need a Savior that needs to come and save us. And thankfully, Jesus came and saved us from our sins, that he raised us from our spiritual death so we can live in abundance of life. And so that we can emulate Jesus, that we can bring the gospel, we can bring the good news to those that need to hear it. So tonight, as we prepare to receive ashes, my prayer is that we will reflect on the goodness of God and what he's done in our life, how he's brought us from the dead, our families, our friends, and our neighbors. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for your love. I thank you for your grace. I thank you for this beautiful story about how Jesus is so intricately involved in his ministry that he knows and loves his disciples so much. Father, we're thankful for the story of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. Father, that we can see this in our own lives, friends that we've lost, loved ones that we have lost, tragically. Father, that we know that we are not alone when we mourn, but we know that you are mourning and praying for us. So, Father, I pray that you would help us to daily pick up our cross and follow you. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
We begin our journey to Easter with the sign of ashes. This ancient sign speaks of the frailty and uncertainty of human life. It calls us to heartfelt repentance and urges us to place our hope in God alone. As Tim Keller has eloquently articulated, the The gospel is this: we are more sinful and flawed in ourselves than we ever dared to believe. Yet all the very same time, we are more loved and accepted in Jesus Christ than we ever dared hope. We receive the ashes as a physical and visual reminder that Jesus has exploded into our lives to rescue us from sin and death. In a moment, we will invite you to come forward to receive the imputation of ashes. Please come down the middle aisle and return to your seat on the outside aisle. If you look on the screen, I'll read something and you will respond by saying amen together. Almighty God, you have created us out of the dust of the earth. May these ashes remind us of our mortality and penitence, and teach us again that only by your gracious gift are we given everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Gracious love and mercy, he breathed into dust the breath of life, creating us to serve him and our neighbors. But during the season of Lent, we remember what we have done with that gift, like a crowd gathered outside of Pilate's palace on Good Friday, calling out for Jesus to be crucified. We have so often rejected God and chosen injustice. And on that day, when Pilate protested that Jesus was innocent, they cried out, "Let his blood be on us and our children.
declaring that they would accept God's judgment for killing an innocent man. But God, by his grace, takes their evil intent and uses it once and for all to defeat Satan, sin, and death for all of us. So during this season, we cry the same thing. Let his blood be on us and our children, because we know that it's only by Jesus' blood shed for us that we can return to life with the Father. Because of God's grace, we have hope. As broken people who have chosen rebellion, who have sought to establish our own kingdoms, who have spurned God our Father and chased after worthless idols, we acknowledge together that it is our sin that breaks the world. We mourn and grieve, knowing that we have sown sin in our lives, and we will reap death. But we do not mourn as those who have no hope, because during this season we also mourn that it is for our sin, in our place, that Jesus went to the cross. We mourn, but with hope, because we know that his dying frees us from death, that his life poured out brings us new life. And when we plumb the depths of our guilt and see that Jesus has cleansed us from it, we can soar to the heights of God's immeasurable love for us. Only the living can mourn. Only the living can change. Let us pray together. Please look at this slide. In this season of repentance, restore to us the joy of our salvation and strengthen us to face our mortality, that we may reach with the confidence of your mercy in Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Now, if you're able to stand, I want to encourage you to stand to receive tonight's benediction. I encourage you to place your hands forward as a symbol of you receiving God's benediction for you this evening. May God the Father, who does not despise the broken spirit, give you a contrite heart. May Christ, who bore our sins in his body on the tree, heal you by his wounds. And may the Holy Spirit, who leads us into all truth, speak to you the words of pardon and peace. Amen. Go in grace and peace tonight.